Today, you're going to meet a young lady who turned her boba dream into a bubble tea reality here in sunny Southern California.
Hi, my name is Pear. I'm 30 years old. I'm originally from Thailand, and I've been living here in the US for almost 6 years now, and I opened the boba shop called Shala Boba for just 3 months ago.
Pear, I love your shop. It is so cute, adorable, it's fun, and most of all, it's Instagrammable.
Thank you.
And just to let everyone know, we are on a really, really busy street. There's people walking back and forth, looking in the windows. We got cars all over the place, traffic, trucks, motorcycles. So just in case you hear any background noise, don't let it bother you. Just know that that's the location that we're in. So I have questions from my subscribers on YouTube. Mm-hmm. So is that okay with you?
Yeah, sure.
Perfect. Okay, so Pear, tell us a little more about yourself and your inspiration for opening your shop.
One of the most inspirations for me is me and my husband and my sister. We love boba. We love to drink boba all the time. And we think about doing something. And also on the pandemic, it make us stay home a lot. So we have a lot of time to think about it and then we do it. And I am one of the most fan of you because I love your channel so much, and I talked to my husband that we really appreciate what you've done for us. Like you put a lot of effort and detail in your YouTube video, and I learned a lot. And one of my most favorite video is you like teaching us how to brew the tea, black tea, green tea, and also how to make the large batch of boba and how to make the syrups, and all of our customers compliment like, this is really good boba.
Thank you so much. That's so kind. So I think your story will be very inspirational for a lot of women out there who maybe also not from the country that they're starting their business in. Could you share a little more about that?
Yeah, I think that just me and my husband, I met my husband and we both have the same, like we like boba. And I've been living here for like 6 years and I want to do something for our future. So we think about that we have to do it and then we do it. Just do it.
Because you're originally from Thailand.
Yeah.
And then you moved here and you were still kind of trying to figure out life. But then you segued into actually becoming a business owner. So what was that journey like for you?
To be honest, I used to work in the restaurant for like 5 years, but I'm sick of it. Like I'm so tired of it. And like I told you that the pandemic, like we have a lot of time to stay home. We don't really work that much at that time. So we have more time to think about what we really want. And we just like find a location and we put all effort to it and we just build it, yeah. Make it happen.
Also, I know from visiting Thailand myself that a lot of businesses there are run by women. They're women-led companies. They're the ones that are the really hard workers. And do you feel like that culture you brought to America when you moved here and that was your mentality?
Of course, yes. Yeah. Yes, we work a lot. We work hard. Me and my sister, we put all the effort that we have and we work so hard for this place.
And are your family and friends in Thailand, are they just so proud of you?
Yes, I think so. Yeah. Yeah, my parents, like they're proud of me right now because I finally do something for myself.
Yeah. You've definitely done something that majority of people won't do, will never do, or just simply are afraid to do, which is to actually open a brick and mortar location like this. It's a lot of work, it's a lot of preparation. Can you share with our viewers some of the preparation that you needed to do in order to open the shop?
First of all, I go online to see what I need and I print it out and I read through all of the things that I need to do, all of the document, location. We find a location and we found this place and we liked it because it's on the corner. And then we have to find our like unique style that we wanted to do. And we just have to do it.
Right.
Yeah.
So it sounds like you had to do the groundwork, mm-hmm. and you made a list, you prepared.
Yeah.
Then once all of that was ready, then you looked to what is the feel of the place? What's the brand of the place? What are we representing with our business and with our company? Okay, so that sounds great. And then what was the logistics of actually, you had to sign a lease or did you actually buy this location?
I actually just signed a lease. Yeah. So we just called a landlord and come see the location, and we decided to do here and we signed a lease. And then they give us some time for free to like decoration and build like interior stuff.
And for your branding, what sort of inspiration did you have for your branding?
It's called Shala Boba. Cha is basically mean tea in Thai. So Cha LA. So we meant to be Cha LA. But a lot of people call Shala Shala, so it's like easiest just for them to remember. So it's just good, we're fine with that.
That's really cool. Because I did see Chala Boba and I thought, I bet you it's a play for the cha, which means tea. But I just didn't put two and two together. But of
you
course,
got it?
Cha LA, Chala Boba. Okay, got it. That's great.
So bot name, like we cool with that.
And then I noticed in looking at your menu, can you tell us a little bit about your menu inspiration and how you decided to put it up the way it is right now?
First of all, I want it to be easy for customer to look at it and to see it. I draw it everything myself because I want it to be cute. Thank you.
So you basically organized it in, you've got your specials and your Thai coffee area. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Then you've got your slush and your fresh teas.
Yeah.
Then your smoothies. And then your milk teas.
Yeah, so basically specials came first because we want customers to know about our special, like how good it is. And slushy fresh tea, it doesn't contain milk, so it's easier for them to see this like fresh fruit and not no milk at all. All the smoothie has milk and the milk tea is on the ice.
And in terms of the items that actually made it on the menu, did you just randomly pick flavors? Did you order in a bunch of different sample flavors and try them amongst friends and family? How did you go about creating exactly the flavors that are on there right now?
So like, first of all, we like boba a lot and we tried pretty much every single place around this area around our house, and we just like get an idea of what do they have, and then we just order everything that we want to sell, and we do testing with our family. So we make everything. And then we brought it to our family and friend and just see how this is.
That's really great. You know, that's the exact same thing I did as well. Mm-hmm. I went, right, what are my favorite drinks? And then I sourced different products and I made the drinks. And then I would get my family and friends together and say, okay, try this, try that. What do you think? Mm-hmm. And of course, with my own opinion and my husband's opinion. And then that's kind of how we settled on the first amount of drinks and flavors that we had at our shops. So that's interesting that you did a very similar thing, which I think is quite a successful way to go. That way it's not just reliant upon what you or I think, but what our customer and what our target audience would think as well.
Yeah.
And I also really like the fact that you did put your, because in America we read from left to right. So when someone looks at the menu, they look at the left-hand side first, generally, and then they work their way to the right. So you've got your specials on the left, and then your slushies and your teas, like you said, just in case they're like, oh, I don't really, not sure what's going on. Then they segue into the smoothies and then the milks and the milk teas. So I think that's a really good idea what you did.
Thank you.
And also, you probably know your target market in the area as well. Mm-hmm. I noticed one of the drinks, mango niara, that's a very particular drink for this area. Yeah. How did you decide to put that on your menu?
I know that drink before, and I know that people around here like that because it has Mexican chili spice to it. It has chamoy and tahin and a mango slushy inside of it. When it's mixed, it tastes really good. And we use all the real fruit as well.
But also your black pink and your pink milk, they're not what people would expect, because I know there's a company out there that has the pink drink, but this isn't the pink drink. This is something very specific and unique that you brought and you created yourself. Can you share a little bit about it?
Yeah, we got a lot of questions with those drinks because they don't know, they have no idea what it is. So black pink is made from the pink milk, and the pink milk is made from the something called Sala Cider. So Sala is the fruit from Thailand, and the Sala Cider is, it has some unique taste, like unique smell as well. But yeah, it's like super popular in Thailand, so we decided to brought it here. But the black pink, it's the pink milk smoothie. blended with Oreo.
I've had the pink milk with boba and I loved it. It's one of my favorite drinks and I'm so glad that you recommended it for me because even though I've been to Thailand, I always get Thai iced tea whenever I go. Mm-hmm. I just never even knew that this pink drink existed. So when you said, oh, this pink milk, do you want to try it? It's a Thai drink. And I was like, yeah, I've never had it before. I thought it was the pink chakramur Thai drink, but yeah. I realized it's not actually. So I was really excited when I got to try that drink and I loved it. It's kind of bubblegummy-ish, kind of sweet. It's very unique. It's kind of hard to explain. So I just want to segue back in talking about people who want to open their own shop. Maybe they're afraid or they don't have the confidence. What advice would you give them as a female, but also culturally as a Thai woman? I know when I visited, the women there, you know, they're the boss, right? So what advice would you give to other females?
I would say that it's nothing easy, but when you start it, it's going to all come together. So just be confident and be yourself. Know what you like, know what you're doing. And eventually, if you like to do it, you're going to be successful. That's what I think.
Okay. What about like work ethic? Do you wake up early and go to bed late? Do you work all day? Do you try to have balance?
So right now, I work every day, 7 days a week. It's a lot, but it's kind of like routine for me already. But in the future, I want to hire somebody to be in our team so I have more time for myself, for my family. When we have more time, we can think of something new. We can be more creative.
So perhaps in a sense, for someone who wants to open their business, they should set aside maybe 6 months or a year of their lives to fully dedicate to that, right? It's not something that they can do on the side. Mm-hmm. It should be more of a full focus in order to make it successful.
Yeah.
And then what about in terms of size? Maybe there's a lot of people around the world who just want to have a smaller shop to begin with, or even like a kiosk mm-hmm. or a cart. Would you say that's a good kind of segue into something bigger?
Yes, I think any size of business is good to be started with. So like you start from the small size of business, you can grow to the bigger size. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
For example, my uncle, he live in Thailand. He start off his factory. He's selling tofu, you know, egg tofu. So he start from the small business. He doing it in townhouse, in like the small house. And then he changed it to like a little bit bigger size of house. And now he has his own factory, like very big, and he's like super successful. So that he's my inspiration as well. Yeah.
Oh, that's really nice. Yeah, because I think a lot of people, they think that I need to get a huge shop, or I need to have a huge franchise, or they just, you know, they almost have their end goal in sight and they think they need to start with their end goal. But actually, it's okay to have your end goal, but start small and then work your way larger or bigger.
Absolutely.
Or more. What was your most difficult, unexpected thing about opening your business?
I think the most difficult, unexpected thing for us is the first day that we opened the shop. We have problems in everything. Our sealing machine wasn't working properly. Our tea dispenser is leaking. Our cashiers have problems with everything. So what should be done differently is we should test before. We should try it before. And yeah, we should practice it. Yeah.
Yeah. So would you say a good piece of advice for that would be maybe have your opening day in mind, but do soft opening first, soft launch.
Yeah.
Get all the kinks worked out. Then have your official grand opening and your big launch party.
Yes.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea because for me even, I had everything ready, but in my mind, I wasn't prepared. It was actually kind of the opposite. Like I expected there to be loads and loads of people. And then on the first day, we were sitting around waiting. I had all my staff, all the drinks were ready, the boba was ready, waiting. And then like nobody showed up. Mm-hmm. We had one customer that day. Mm-hmm. I was heartbroken. I was so difficult. But come to find out, and something that, you know, I kind of realized, but I didn't realize the full effect of it, is that the people in my area didn't know what bubble tea was. There was no other bubble tea shops within probably a 30 to 45 mile radius or so. I had to let people know over the course of time, this is what bubble tea is, mm-hmm. try a free sample, come in, here's a coupon, here's a voucher, try this, try that. Yeah. And then eventually they're like, oh, right. yes, this is actually really good. I like bubble tea. And then, of course, it was just natural then that they started coming all the time. Mm-hmm. But that's really interesting. Thank you for sharing that, because I think that's something that a lot of people might not think about. And what do you wish that you would have done differently?
To be honest, I wouldn't change anything in the past, but in the future, like I told you, I want to hire somebody, because right now we all work together every day, so we get tired and we want to have more time to ourselves to thinking about the creating more drink, creating more desserts.
And I know one of the things that you do have is your Thai crepe. Mm-hmm. So a lot of bubble tea shops, they'll do bubble tea and maybe they'll do crepe or brick toast or bubble waffle, but you do something very unique, which is amazing because you're Thai, you do a Thai crepe.
Yeah.
How is that different and how does that add to your menu?
So Thai crepe is the crispy, like crunchy crepes, very unique because people here don't know about it. So we have to introduce them to the customer and they love it. We start having more order of Thai crepes every day. Yeah, this is really good.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's one thing that a lot of people don't think about. If they do introduce something new on the menu that the area isn't used to, if you can give out free samples or let people try it, you know, give it a little bit of time, just don't get frustrated in the beginning if everybody doesn't order it just because they don't know what it is. But if it is actually that good, and of course yours is, like you said, people will try it and then over time they'll just start ordering it naturally because they know how amazing it is. Mm-hmm. So that's really good insight. What do you think you would have wanted to know before you opened your bubble tea shop?
The only thing that I wanted to know before is about all the document, about accountant, because this thing is like make me headache. Because like before we opened the shop, I have to search everything online myself, and I have to read through everything, and there's a lot of stuff, and it's super difficult, all of like the business legalization or something like that. Yeah, it's very hard.
It's really interesting that you say that, because on my website, one of the documentation packets that I have is exactly what you're talking about. You know, a lot of people, they go to my website, they get all the recipes, they get everything else, but they kind of overlook the documentation packets. But those are actually really important and they cause people a lot of time and a lot of headache. And I think it's something that a lot of people don't think about, like you said, before they open their shop.
Yeah.
But then once they get to that point, they're like, oh man, I wish I had something like this. So I would definitely say to people out there, if you're kind of thinking of opening a business, definitely check out my documentation packet because it will definitely make a difference. Okay, two questions for you. First of all, what is your favorite drink from anywhere around the world?
My always favorite drink is had to be Thai tea.
Me too.
I'm not gonna lie.
I love Thai tea.
I know, like, it's boring, but it's my favorite.
Yeah. Have you ever tried the green Thai tea?
Never.
No? Okay. What about the pink Thai tea, the rose version?
No.
No? Okay.
I only try like original orange one.
Yeah.
When I live in Thailand, they have like really good Thai tea because they make it fresh every time when we order it.
Yeah.
They brew the Thai tea in front of us. Mm-hmm. It's really cool.
I know. This is something that I tried to explain to people. I said, if you go to the actual like Thai tea, Cha Thar Mua business, it's gonna cost you Western prices. But if you just go to the street corner, little vendor, shop vendor, they're gonna make it for you, and it's just as tasty, just as fresh, and it's just as amazing.
Yeah,
so
I miss those.
Yeah, me too. And then at your business, what is your favorite drink on the menu?
Blackpink is my favorite one. Also a brown sugar milk tea.
Ooh, brown sugar milk tea.
And a Thai tea.
Yeah. That's very, very trendy right now, the brown sugar milk tea.
It's really good. We sell a lot of them too.
As a logistical question, you open your shop at 11:30 a.m. What time do you or your team arrive to start setting up everything and getting everything going for the day?
Yeah, so we arrive between 10 to 10:30 every day because cooking boba is take at like almost 1 hour.
And the teas?
Yeah, the teas, your recipe, 7 to 10 minutes for the tea, yeah. It's not gonna be that long, but boba is the main lead that we have to come early.
And for your supply levels of like your Thai crepe, for example, do you just make more when and as needed, or is that something you do every morning?
The batter is good for like 2 days, so we make every other day.
And for ordering your stock, is that something you do as needed, or is that something you do monthly? How does that flow for you?
We do every 2 weeks, but if something out of stock, we do every week.
And in terms of advice, what would be your best advice that just pops off the top of your head that you would tell someone out there who is interested or really wants to or is about to open their own bubble tea shop?
First of all, you have to know that you really liked it and just learn a lot from it before you do it and prepare, make a list and have a plan. That's just very important.
Okay, so have passion, be open-minded, be able and willing to learn, and then have a plan and put that plan into action.
Yes.
Awesome. That's really great advice.
Thank you.
Could you let us know a little bit of a time frame of what it was like for you? So your kind of creation of the thought of wanting to own a bubble tea shop, the actual starting of kind of creating it, and then the actual opening process. What's kind of a time frame that you experienced?
I always think about open the bubble shop like for 5 years, I guess. But we really have time during COVID-19 lockdown, and we talk about it, and we take an action on November, and we start opening it on January 9th. So about 2 months and 10 days.
I think that's actually very similar for me as well, because I always wanted to open a bubble tea shop, and then I kind of, in my mind, was always planning. I did, you know, training and preparation, but then the actual time that it takes to kind of find a location, sign the lease, and get it open, it's really quick, actually. It's only a couple of months.
Yeah.
And then once your shop's open, then it's kind of like a continuous improvement, changing, kind of feeling it out, changing recipes over time maybe as well. So that's interesting. It's very similar. All right, so we just moved to this back area so you can see another space of Chala Boba. And I just want to let you guys know, part two will be coming out soon, where Pear takes you behind the scenes of her shop, behind the counter, so you can get a little more insight into everything. In the meantime, I want to say, Pear, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Such an amazing experience. Please be sure to click that like button and subscribe if you haven't already. Be sure to leave a comment below, and we'll see you again soon. Bye-bye.
Sadika.